Hello everyone, I'm Olga from hbury.com and welcome. Today we are going to learn different types of sewing pins and their uses. A few years ago I walked into Michael's store in Canada to buy some pins for sewing and was surprised to find an entire aisle full of different types. Which kind do I need? It was a daunting experience. And I left without buying anything, because I truly couldn't decide in the store and wanted to go online to read about different types of sewing pins. But the next day I was in a dollar store, and they had pins for sewing, only one type. So it was easy to decide, and I happily bought these nice sparkling pins that had large bright heads. I thought they would be great for my projects and their big heads would make it easy for me to pull them out as I was sewing. But soon I learned the hard way that there are different types of pins for a reason. Those dollar store pins were too thick for most of my projects and they had very blunt tips. If you ask any sewist about sewing pins, you will find out they are a must-have tool for sewing, as they perform many crucial tasks. But this is a topic for another video. While you are here, I invite you to subscribe to my YouTube channel. This channel is updated weekly, well, almost weekly, with free sewing projects and tutorials such as the one you are going to see today. I am so happy that you have joined me. So let's learn how to choose different types of pins for sewing and quilting. Let's talk about straight pins now. Straight pins are the most commonly used pins for sewing, also known as basting pins or hemming pins. You will choose which option to use based on the type of head, length of the pin, thickness, the pin tip. Each pin is comprised of these four basic parts. What is the head? The head of the pin is the piece at the end that you can grab and hold on to. Heads can vary in shape, size, color, and materials. Plastic heads. This common style comes in large variety, easy for grabbing and seeing the pins against your fabric. But these heads can melt from the heat of the iron and potentially ruin both your fabric and your iron. These are good all-around pins as long as you don't need to iron your project. You can also find the heads in different shapes, such as a heart, which can help make them easier to grab. Recently, they made pins with plastic heads that are heat-resistant. In stores, they are called magic pins. These heads have a cylindrical shape. They are called magic pins, I guess, because they are heat resistant and easy to grab. Glass heads. Glass head pins are practically identical to plastic heads, except that the glass head won't melt when ironed. This style is often a thinner pin, making them good for use with fussier fabrics that show holes more easily, like silk. The glass head is usually smaller than the plastic head and more difficult to grasp. Metal head pins. These are traditionally called dressmaker pins. These flat head pins have been around the longest and are good for many sewing projects and for use when ironing your project. They can be difficult to sport when used on textured or patterned fabric. They are also more difficult to grasp. These pins are usually made of stainless steel and are rust proof. They are strong but thin enough that they will hold most fabrics together without creating large holes. 20 years ago, I used mostly this type of pins, but now I don't even have them and prefer glass head pins. The metal head can also resemble a nail head. Extra fine silk pins have this kind of heads, so if you sew a lot with natural silk fabric, it makes sense to use them. Now let me tell you about pin length and why it's important. The shaft of a sewing pin is that skinny metal part that extends from the head of the pin to the tip of the pin, and it can vary in length. Some sewing projects need long pins, while others require short pins. How do you know which pin length to use for what project? Basically, for most projects using light to medium weight fabrics, you will likely use medium length pins that are between 1 and 1.5 inches long. Longer pins are easier to use, but it's not necessary for lightweight fabric. Quilting and other multi-layered projects require longer pins in order to pin through several layers of fabric, without being concerned that the pins will fall out. Common quilting pin lengths are 1¾–2 inches. Short pins are best for very small projects or attaching appliques, sequins, or trims. They are even called applique pins sometimes. You can use them to position and hold appliques in place. Their short length is great for close pinning of small appliques. But basically, any project where you need pins very close together and long pins may overlap awkwardly is a good one for short pins. They are small but secure the layers well and tough enough to go through the applique, the stabilizer, and the fabric. I like to mark my fabric with short pins and transfer pattern lines to my fabric because sometimes you just cannot mark fleece or fur with a regular marker. Here I have fleece fabric and irregular fabric markers don't leave any visible lines. So I use short pins instead with big heads. I don't use longer pins because they scratch me easily. So pin exactly in the dart point and afterwards mark the point on both pattern pieces. What is pin width or thickness? The goal is to use the thinnest pin you can to accomplish the project you are working on, to avoid leaving unsightly holes. The type of fabric you are using as well as the project you are doing will determine your pin thickness. Use regular pins for most projects. Those pins will measure 0.6 mm in thickness. When working with less forgiving fabrics like silk, use thinner silk pins that measure 0.4–0.5 mm in thickness. Finally, when working with heavy fabrics, you may need to use pins that measure 0.7 or 0.8 mm thick. Make sure to test your pins in your fabric first before committing to a thickness. For example, here I have a piece of natural silk fabric. Thicker pins will leave holes in this delicate silk. Let me show you. You cannot use quilting pins for this fabric. This thick pin destroys the delicate silk. Even thinner pins might leave holes. Let's see. I will use this very thin pin. Did it leave a hole? Nope. This pin is great to use for silk fabric. But if you use thin pins for heavy fabric, they will bend easily. Look what happens to a thin pin if I use it for a quilt project. Heavy fabrics require thicker pins. Next, we are going to see what is the tip of a pin. Just as the head length and width of pins can vary, so can the tip. You can find sharp, extra sharp, or ballpoint tips. Sharp tips are the most common kind, which you will use for the majority of your projects. you will only need different tips for a few projects. Extra sharp or extra fine points are usually on very thin pins and are meant to be used on projects using silk and other delicate fabrics. Ballpoint tips are most rounded or blunt, and these tips are used for stretchy fabrics and needs so that the tips don't snag the fabric. These tips push the fibers aside instead of piercing them. Here I have ballpoint pins. They are like ballpoint sewing needles. Let's try to use these pins for very delicate knit silk fabric. See? Absolutely no holes. But you don't really need them. For this fabric I can use thin silk pins and they will leave no holes either. You have to remember that a pin can become blunt in time. Dull pins are no good to use. They can pierce the fabric, break the fibers, and leave big holes. So from time to time you will need to change your pins and buy new ones. Let me show you how you can determine that the pin became dull. I usually hear a punching sound when the bad pin enters the fabric. And the good sharp pin doesn't make any sound. I usually throw away pins like this so they don't break my fabric. Now let's see sewing pins materials. It's important to be aware of the metal content of sewing pins in case you are allergic to certain metals or live in a humid area. Sewing pins can be made of stainless steel, nickel-plated, chrome-plated or brass. Nickel is a common allergen. Nickel is one of the most common causes of allergic contact dermatitis, a skin rash or irritation caused by touching nickel. So make sure you are not allergic to nickel if you use nickel-plated pins. But if you are not, the pins that contain nickel as nickel-plated pins are the most rust-resistant. These pins are stainless steel, but most pins that I have are nickel-plated steel, so they are rust-resistant. Let's continue our talk about types of sewing pins. The confusing thing about sewing pins is that when you walk into an aisle in the store, you see dozens of different names for pins. However, when you break it down into simple terms, those varieties are just variations of straight pins. Quilting pins. Quilting pins are longer and stronger than normal plastic head pins, so that they can hold multiple layers of a quilt together. They have big, brightly colored plastic heads to make them easy to spot. As these pins are longer and thicker than other pins, take care to only use them with fabric that can handle them. Since ironing usually occurs before or after pinning, melting the plastic heads isn't normally a problem or concern. Pearl head pins. Pearl head pins are shaped similar to plastic head pins, but look so nice. Let me tell you a fun story. Once I bought a box of pearlized pins, but in the description it was a typo and it was written pearlized. And I'm not the only one. I found this question on Amazon. Last detail in description says pins are pearlized. How are pins pearlized? And the seller wrote the answer. Pearlized is just an unfortunate typo for pearlized, referring to the heads. We will contact Amazon to help get that fixed. Thanks for pointing it out. Silk pins. Silk isn't a self-repairing fabric, so you will want to use extra fine pins when working with silk to prevent large noticeable holes in your finished product. Most of the time silk pins are all metal and come in a variety of weights, but I have silk pins with small glass heads. They are easier to grasp and don't leave holes in silk fabric, so I prefer to use them. pins, featuring a T-shaped head. These heavy duty pins are great to use with upholstery, tough fabrics, or pinning through buttonholes. Look, if you pin the T-pin like this, the layers will stay put as the buttonhole cannot be open. You need it sometimes, right? But I use T-pins in my embroidery projects, especially with big hoops. Let me show you. So you take a big hoop, not like this, but bigger, hoop an embroidery stabilizer. I use these pins mostly for freestanding lace embroidery projects. So the stabilizer is wash away stabilizer. And now I pin like this, very close to the hoop sides. So during embroidery, the stabilizer doesn't shrink, especially when the embroidery design is very dense. Next, decorative straight pins. They usually have bigger heads to make it even easier to see them. Plus, they are just fun to use. Let me show you also these pins called tidy pins. What are these? Do you know? They are used for holding different covers in place. Arm covers on a couch or chair, sleep covers, bed skirts. So if you sew these kinds of covers, you can use these pins. And in the end, I would like to tell you my opinion on a frequently asked question. Do you sew over pins? Well, 20 years ago, I would say definitely yes. You see, when I learned to sew, I was told that it's perfectly fine to sew over pins because they are thin. And I did it all the time and I liked it. But now, after so many sewing projects, I will say, don't do it. Don't sew over pins. It's quite dangerous. Look what happens to a pin when the sewing machine needle steps on it. At the same time, the fabric goes in the hole in the needle plate under the presser foot, and you cannot take it out of there without cutting your project. And this is what happens with the needle. Yes, it doesn't happen very often, only once in a while, but it does happen. So no, don't sew over pins. Take them out as soon as your presser foot reaches them. Thank you so much for joining me on this sewing tutorial. And once again, I invite you to subscribe and take a look around and some of the other tutorials on my channel that might be useful to you. Please share this video and give it a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. And I will see you again next week. Happy sewing!